too short. It's just been too short most of the day as Bishop. It's not as quick as a normal oval pitch, I keep saying that. See, that's just banged in, it's got width as well. They're easy balls to hit and put away very nicely.
There's seven more added to take the score along to 233 for five at the close of play. A good performance there from Graham Thorpe. I thought he played quite beautifully today. Timing and footwork magnificent. Crawley batted well for his 50, Atherton for his 36, and Hick on 43 and Russell 9 have the opportunity on the second day to put things right for England. It's a nice even contest at the moment. Bowling figures for the West Indies. Ambrose 3 for 52. I thought he bowled really well today. He's come back refreshed. It was just what he needed, a bit of a break. Benjamin bowled well, 1 for 46, and Hooper 1 for 34. Did a good job there, just resting the pace bowler, 16 overs and 7 maidens for him.
Talking to me?
When a man on the edge.
Highlighted action from the day's events at the Oval now on BBC Two in the sixth test. It's introduced by Richie Benno.
Test cricket can be a very cruel game. Alan Wells found that out the hard way yesterday at the Oval. After patiently waiting for his first England call-up, the Sussex captain lasted just one ball. Test matches have a habit of swinging on such moments. Another man who's had a mixed season is Graham Hick. Last night he survived an early bombardment and then led a wonderful fight back in the final session. At the start of play this morning, England's hopes of victory rested on his shoulders and on those of Jack Russell. Welcome to the highlights of the second day of the sixth Cornhill Test match, the final one in the series. A wonderful day yesterday. I thoroughly enjoyed it. Lovely and fluctuating, as indeed has been the whole series. This is the way it began this morning. 233 for 5, 36 to Atherton, 50 to Crawley, who played well under pressure. Thorpe, I thought, a great innings for 74, and Hick unbeaten on 43. With Jack Russell. 21 extras in the 233 and the bowling figures for the West Indies. I thought they were much too short all the way through. Ambrose 3 for 52, Walsh none for 37, Benjamin 1 for 46, Bishop no wicket for 53, and Hooper 1 for 34. Well, yesterday there was plenty of bounce in this pitch. Here with his report now on the second day is Geoffrey Boycott.
Second morning, a bit overcast and breezy, but still very pleasant. We look at this pitch. It's still very dry. It's like a fourth or fifth day normal oval pitch. You've got one or two little cracks here, look. You'll get the odd low ball from these. One or two stud marks, a fast bowler went around the wicket. A couple of stud marks here. Because there's so little to see, you can see any stud marks at all. You can see this side, the spinner might be able to bowl into these when the West Indian left-handers are batting. But all in all, you've got to say this is a very flat, good batting pitch. Really does have to bend his back here.
And that'll be very good news for Graham Hick and Jack Russell, who were the men going out to the centre. The big surprise for me at the start was that Curtly Ambrose wasn't used. It was Courtney Walsh and Ian Bishop. I thought Ambrose would have been into the attack straight away. At any rate, we join it with the first ball of the fifth over. Eight runs have been added. It is Courtney Walsh bowling, and Graham Hick is taking strike.
Beautiful shot, perfectly timed, well executed. First time that Courtney Walsh is over pitch this morning, Graham Hick was immediately onto it. Just about half volley length, and the bounce is perfect. Timing, no chance, four run.
It was full meat of the bat. Now Hick's on 49. runs on 50. And that's a really good innings. State of the game yesterday when he came in, that's top class. A bit of courage has gone into that after what yesterday was a very ordinary beginning. Good slower ball, but neatly dealt with by Jack Russell. That's good stroke. .250 up for five. I'd have thought the tactics this morning are self-defeating for West Indies. They're 11 overs into the second new ball. Start of the second morning. Big opportunity for the West Indies bowlers to get through. Good shots.
Just helped away by Jack Russell. And those gentlemen in total agreement with the umpire. That's a great shot. Beautifully placed. Courtney Walsh has strayed too often this morning.
Well, if anything, Courtney Walsh here is either bowling too short or too well up, and that was very badly directed, just about middle and leg. Batsmen love those. There's no way you should be out LBW playing that, and it's more or less a free hit to mid-wicket.
It's in the air, wide of Brian Lara at square leg. He's going to get four more for it. Almost deceived by the slower ball from Courtney Walsh. Although he was just a fraction early on the shot, he managed to get the ball directly between Shervin Campbell at short leg and then Brian Lara at backward square leg. A half bad misfield, that's the West Indies captain in trouble. It'll only cost him two. Trevor McDonald there, a great fan of cricket and West Indies cricket in particular. Keen student of the game, he's read all the books, watched a lot of cricket in his time. Might just have taken the glove on the way down. Signalled his four runs. It didn't carry anyway to Courtney Brown.
Well, there were shouts of catch it to this. I think Courtney Brown would have been miraculous had he taken that. It was in front of him on the leg side. Very difficult, not counted as a chance.
Must be that the best two bowlers for West Indies, Ambrose and Kenny Benjamin, can't get hold of the newest ball. Two bowlers who've not been successful, Walsh and Bishop, and have not looked like taking wickets, have been bowling. I mean, Bishop to me, Charlie Halfway, is halfway down the pitch all the time.
That's four. Very well played by Jack Russell. Nicely timed, beautifully placed.
Yes, I mean, if you were Jack Russell, who would you like to face? Kirkley Ambrose or Hooper? Nice little steady off-spinner. Pick your spot on a very flat pitch. Thank you very much.
Kirtley Ambrose making a belated appearance. Well, we haven't seen many get past the bat this morning. This is the right line from Kirtley Ambrose. That's actually a beautiful delivery, just enough cut to beat the defensive shot. and he's got away with it. That ball really flew high and fast.
Well, it bounced a little bit here. It was wide enough to hit, but it just bounced on Graham Hick. Keeper got a glove on it, but couldn't hang on.
Beautifully played. Anything that's slightly short from Carl Hooper and also slightly wide like this is real meat and drink to Graham Hick. And the Hundred partnership comes up between Graham Hick and Jack Russell. That's been a very valuable, very good partnership for England.
Money for old rope is Carl Hooper. You only get yourself out. Long on here, coming into our picture. Well, that's what he thinks of Carl Hooper.
And the fielders run in from the boundary to pick up the ball while Hip takes three runs.
Well, it's like taking candy from kids, Carl Hooper bowling on this pitch.
Up 301 for 5, 14 now to Russell and 76 to Hick.
I know the West Indies bowlers don't like bowling around the wicket, but that's the sort of line that they're bowling, and Jack Russell does not like it when they come around the wicket like that.
Thirdly, Ambrose is furious with himself, waiting for the tide to turn. That was a good run. It was an easy run. The problem is with Jack Russell is that he threatens to run these short singles so often. It must be a terrible feeling that he's selling the dummy to the batsman at the other end. Is he for real? And Graham Hick says, yes, come on.
He's got some problems now. Now, totally in defense.
The urgency now for these two batsmen to see it through to lunch. The urgency very much for West Indies to snap out of it and pick up a wicket. Looked for a moment to me as though he lost it in the background.
Jack Russell expected the ball to bounce a little bit more because that was pulled just about outside off stump, the square leg. And under normal circumstances, would have been straight in. As easy a catch as you could get a square leg. Not been a very good session for the West Indies.
Gone through him. It hasn't hit his bat. It's come off his waistband or trousers or something like that. Was a hell of a delivery.
This is a good ball. It takes off a little bit. A lot of pace in this and bunk.
That's a chase for Chandler Paul, just to add a bit of insult to the injury of the drop chance. Two runs made by England this morning. It would be an understatement to say that's beyond their wildest dreams. And that's a good performance from Graham Hick in this series against the West Indies. And got him. Well, Kenny Benjamin has done it. Graham Hick goes four short of 100. Just 5 minutes from lunch on the second day. It's the only breakthrough for West Indies this morning.
caught by Stuart Williams off Kenny Benjamin's bowling for 96. And that goes down with me as the best innings I've seen Graham Hick play. It was neatly caught by Stuart Williams. Good ball, it left him. Williams took it just on his right-hand side. Very safely, he's got a good pair of hands, Stuart Williams. Look what comes in, the new batsman. Jack Russell on 48, 336, 46. Been a very good session for England.
I think they've got to change the thinking about Kenny Benjamin. Sometimes he should be bowling with a new ball, or at least first change. He didn't get a bowl till after, 25 minutes to lunch.
There's 50 for Jack Russell. The punch of the bat denotes his satisfaction. That's been a very important innings as far as England are concerned in this final test match of the series. Graham Hick, happy enough with 96. Disappointed not to have turned it into successive hundreds. Exciting game, test cricket. I think that just carried. Courtney Brown again diving away in front of the slips.
Well, big disappointment for Kenny Benjamin. I don't think it was so easy for the keeper, but you've got to call it a chance.
Well, it went to hands. It would be very harsh to put it down as a chance. Erwin Campbell at short leg, he has some great reflexes. This was not middled. What you might call a pretty firm poke. Ian Bishop making his way up the steps. Which means that Keith Arterton is back on the field, regular substitute. That's a good shot. Found the gap brilliantly. The time that they pitch on Jack Russell's leg stump like this, it's gone for four. That's close again to Sherwin Campbell. This time hit more firmly than the previous chance in Kenny Benjamin's previous over. Campbell's still pretty deep at short leg. Brings up the England 350 as they move on to 351.
There's some mental problems out there. Richie Richardson, the West Indian captain. Not many will agree with his approach to the day's play with the early bowl for Carl Hooper. But his fast bowlers certainly have given him every possible effort.
Well, that's a wonderful shot. Wonderful shot.
I think the game was slightly put away from the West Indies by some of the worst captains we have seen for a long time. Ambrose did not start this morning and started only after about an hour of really inept bowling by both Bishop and Courtney Walsh.
Well, he kept it down quite brilliantly because he manufactures his own stroke. Now, don't go into the back garden and practice that, because you probably scoop it through a neighbour's greenhouse.
I don't think you'll see this shot in anybody's coaching manual, but effective.
When you place very close fielders, there are very big gaps behind them. That's Mickey Stewart. Interesting spectator. That's short and really punished. Cracking shot by Jack Russell. Very unusual piece of bowling from Kenny Benjamin, who really has been the bowler who's kept the ball up to the bat. Witnesses 10 wickets at Trent Bridge.
A little nick and that's it, and up go the arms of Courtney Walsh. His 300th test wicket has come at last. It seemed an endless wait for him. 300 wickets, an absolute totem pole of an achievement. Applause now thickening right around the ground. And Mike Watkinson will be in the record books, at least Courtney Walsh's record books, and this is how it happened.
Now Courtney Walsh is going to remember this for a long time. Just the top edge of the bat there, and Courtney Brown did not have any mistakes. So two Courtneys involved, but I think the one that's most important is Courtney Walsh. 300 test wicket at 24.82. Tremendous effort. Certainly achieve something as only two West Indians have done so far beside him, that's Lance Gibbs and Malcolm Marshall.
Dominic Cork is the new batsman, and we have a change in bowling. Kenny Benjamin takes a rest, Ian Bishop returns with just one slip in this time, and immediately Bishop decides to go around the wicket. Sweet shot. Lovely shift of the weight onto the front foot. Classic. There we go. Ian Bishop considers what might have been had there been a third slip. 11 runs off the over. 383 for 7. Unusual.
But he got away with it and it barely raced away down to the third man down. And up comes the 400.
That's got away nicely. Now there was a brush on the way through as Dominic Cork went for the run. Kirtley Ambrose certainly wasn't moving out of the way. Worth a comment and worth a stare.
Yes, Kirtley wasn't best pleased because technically he's not supposed to get out of the way. It's the batsman that's got to run round the bowler. Dominic Cork is a confident sort of player, running with his head down, just runs into him.
Well, I might just argue with that, Geoffrey. Dominic, to me there, looked as though he'd made to try and get round Kirtley, who actually handed him off. Not quite as powerfully as Jonah Lomu, but there was a little bit of aggro in there. I bowled him. Kirtley Ambrose strikes. And Jack Russell has the top of his off stump clipped by the West Indies leading bowler. It's the end of a very fine innings indeed by the England wicketkeeper. 221 deliveries it lasted, 292 minutes. Finally succumbing to a good delivery from Kirtley Ambrose right on the stroke of two.
Well, I know it's a pretty good ball, but I just wonder if there's a little bit of tiredness in this. It just slants across him. You see the bit of movement, but he's been playing those pretty well all day. He's been at the wicket now 4 hours today, about an hour yesterday. Pitches about leg and middle somewhere, leg stump, hits the top of off stump, so that's a good ball.
Dominic Cork's 19, not out.
and he's been joined now by Angus Fraser. Haven't quite got onto that. Doubt if it actually met the bat. Looked more as though it might have got him on the fingers.
First time I've seen Cork try to hook here. Got onto him, I think, quicker than he expected. Hit the top of the bat and dropped well short of the man at fine leg, but he seems to have a problem with his leg. Running, he seemed to be limping just now.
Malcolm is ready to test four-man pace attack at the West Indies. I don't think that's what England had in mind with Dominic Cork. Maybe calling for a runner. Yeah, well, you never know with body language these days, do you? It looks as though he wants a throat spray, but he's limping. It's got to be a connection somewhere, but I dread to think what it is. Well, I reckon Dominic Cork did the damage when he played that hook shot off Ian Bishop. Played it there. Came off his hand. The effort of swinging around to play that hook shot, it looks as though he might have damaged a groin muscle. Well, he's waiting on a runner. Well, I quite like that. I think Wells has got a bit of character. As I thought yesterday when he took off his helmet and walked back bareheaded, didn't hide behind the anonymity of a grill and a helmet yesterday after he'd got a first baller. And now he's taken the chance to get out there again and act as runner. The only scenario we wouldn't really want to see is for him to be run out. It's quick work, but not quite quick enough to get Fraser.
Quite sure how that missed. Just snuck through the gap. It was a perfect yorker. I suppose nigh on perfect. Had it been perfect, it would have hit the stumps, but snuck through there, just missing leg stump. That's bowling. That's perfectly directed. Had a practice run early in the over. That's nothing if not a problem for Dominic Cork this time. Finally bowled. Cork goes for 33. So Kirtley Ambrose has his reward for plenty of effort. 5 wickets in the innings.
This has been a superb spell of fast bowling. Not a great amount of luck today, but stuck with it. Now it's 42nd over.
And there's the state of England's first innings. That's a healthy total, 443. One more wicket still to fall. Place your bets now. Devon Malcolm facing Kirtley Ambrose. Shots. That's the way to play, Dev.
This shot here has brought up the biggest roar of the day.
innings here. No ball called to start with. Kirtley Ambrose doing the right thing, still trying to fire in these Yorkers. They're a contented captain. Very happy to watch from the comfort of the dressing rooms here. Someone else looks vaguely familiar too, and far more active. Angus Fraser out of the firing line. England on to 450. Well, Kenny Benjamin going round the wicket. Another short leg comes up. That doesn't bode well. Well, throwbacks. Devin Malcolm, immediately having played that shot, looked at the bat. Almost as though he wasn't sure whether it was he or the bat that was responsible for the shot.
I think there's a piece of the bat that has been taken out with that shot. It must have been hit with tremendous power.
That skied over cover and caught. So a good catch by Brian Lara to wrap up this England innings. Who knows if that little bit of bat had still been left on. Devin Malcolm might just have cleared Brian Lara there, but an entertaining finish to this England innings.
That was a great performance from England, 233 for 5 at the start of play, and then 454 all out. That's the best innings I've ever seen Graham Hick play, 96, and Jack Russell did a great job also for his 91. And the bottom of the order, I thought, did wonderfully well. 13, 33, 10 and 10. To take it up with the extras to 454. And just to underline what a terrific job was done with those later order batsmen, as well as the ones at the start and in the middle. The partnerships there up the top, 51, 89, 43, but then Hick and Russell, which ended today 144, and from there down to the end, 36, 47, 24 and 11. Now, it's a very good looking list of partnerships, and it's reflected in the West Indian bowling figures. Kirtley Ambrose, I thought he was outstanding. 42 overs, 10 maidens, 5 for 96. He bowled with intelligence as well as skill. Not always the case with the other bowlers. Courtney Walsh picked up his 300th test match wicket, 32 overs, 6 maidens and 1 for 84. Kenny Benjamin moved the ball in the air, but by and large, apart from Ambrose, I thought they were far too short. We join the West Indies innings now. It's the second ball of the first over. Devin Malcolm is the bowler. Stuart Williams has taken strike and there were no runs on the board.
That's the first boundary of the innings. Second ball of the innings, first four of the innings. Stuart Williams, not one to hang around.
Well, he's also a batsman we've seen in the test match that he played. He likes the ball short of length.
That's flowing through slip. Well, the runs are flying off the edge of this bat. Well, part of the middle, part of the edge.
Well, I thought that was a pretty decent length of ball, David. I thought that was a rash shot.
Cracking shot. Well, I'm not certain about the footwork, but the backwork was scintillating.
Yes, he won't play a better shot than this. But look at the feet, they've not moved. We get a pitch where it moves about a bit, he's going to have a few problems.
And again, no negligible footwork, plenty of bat work, and really it looks as though Stuart Williams has just wandered into the nets. Oh,
Another good shot. Watkinson is chasing. Russell won't make it. Norwell Fraser coming in.
Well thought out, well bowled. A bit of luck gone for Sherwin Campbell, and this is the kind of luck that England's had, so it goes both ways.
Given in. Williams goes. No doubt there's a sound, but I don't know that Williams is totally enamoured of the decision.
Well, his initial action suggests that he didn't think that he was out. He did seem to drop the handle before the ball actually passed him, and surely that did not hit his glove, and surely didn't hit the bat. This position, it does suggest to me that it did not hit anywhere that should have been given out.
They don't mind working their fast bowlers hard these days, Colin. They've shoved Kenny Benjamin in to come out as night watchman. For the over. The crowd roared as soon as he put up the one finger. Might be something the ICC need to look at. Otherwise there'll be a few batsmen out there having mild coronaries. Certainly could pose some problems for batsmen if umpires keep on doing that. Stuart Williams, the man there who might have been just a shade unlucky, got by Russell off Malcolm for 30. Campbell unbeaten on 17, Kenny Benjamin the night watchman on 2, there's one extra and it's 50 for 1. Now the bowling figures, Malcolm 7 overs, 2 maidens, 1 for 31, Fraser 5 overs, 3 maidens, no wickets for 10, and Watkinson 1 over for 8, 2 short balls there, and he does have an injured hand. That's the way the game is after the second evening of the 6th Cornhill Test match, England 454, West Indies 50 for 1, and West Indies 400 and 4 runs behind. And here with his ideas on how the day went and what might happen tomorrow is Geoffrey Boycott.
It was England's day in terms of ability and good fortune. The good fortune came early in the morning when Richie Richardson inexplicably did not bowl Ambrose for 45 minutes with the new ball, and he didn't bowl the other best bowler of yesterday, which was Kenny Benjamin, for over 100 minutes. I couldn't understand it. I thought it was appalling captaincy. It gave England the opportunity to get set against the least effective bowlers, Walsh and Bishop, and then the little lollipop slow bowling of Hooper. They took full advantage of it. Hick played splendidly. He looks very, very comfortable to me at number 5. I hope England don't experiment and put him earlier up the order. Keep him at number 5. He looks really good. Jack Russell, well, he's a priceless commodity. Gritty, great character, fights. He doesn't have a lot of shots, but I like him. He really is a Jack Russell terrier. He's a good one. And then right at the end of the day, West Indies had the misfortune to have a terrible mistake against them. I'm glad it was a neutral umpire from India and not an Englishman, because that decision left West Indies, I'm sure, fuming in the dressing room. Tomorrow, England have to bowl well, but to strike early, get amongst the West Indians and try and make them follow on.
3 more days to go in this Cornhill match and we'll be on air tomorrow. That's the time, 10:45 a.m, BBC One. The third day of the 6th Cornhill Insurance Test match here at the Oval. At the moment from the great ground, it's goodbye.
Day 3 at the Oval.